हेलो राकेश जी। हेलो मिस्टर राकेश।
यस सर, यस सर।
हाँ काइंडली मेक मिस्टर अभिषेक घोष एंड डॉक्टर इम्तियाज अहमद सोफी को होस्ट।
ओके सर, ओके। हाँ
दीज बोथ विल बी आंसरिंग टुडे। दिस मीटिंग इज रिकॉर्डेड।
सर, यस सर, रिकॉर्डेड सर ऑलरेडी।
ओके
खुशमा
गुड इवनिंग सर
अचिन
हाँ गुड इवनिंग सर
गुड इवनिंग हु इज आंसरिंग टुडे
सर मिस डॉक्टर अभिषेक घोष एंड डॉक्टर इम्तियाज
वन सेकंड
गुड इवनिंग हिरेन भाई
हाय महेंद्र
गुड इवनिंग
गुड इवनिंग अभिषेक
And Imtiaz sir.
And Imtiaz, na?
Good evening, Gaurang Shah sir. Good evening, Hiran Chuda sir.
Hi, good evening. You are answering Abhishek?
Yes, sir.
Good evening.
I am happy, Abhishek. You are taking active participation in this.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Gita sir has joined, na?
Yes, sir, he has joined.
Dr. Ganesh Bakshi?
Sir, has not joined.
Mahendra? Dr. Mahendra.
Mine, sir, is busy on phone, sir.
Okay. You know, I just wanted to know that Ganesh is still traveling and he has already reached.
Hi, sir. Sorry, sir.
Mahendra, he has reached or he is still traveling?
Sir, Dr. Ganesh just called me. He just reached home and he will be joining.
Okay. No problem.
Yeah.
So we just wait for one or two minutes, then we start.
Okay, sir.
Sumendra, you know who we go about, na? The thing is, like in exam,
yes, sir.
So you know it very well. So how they ask in exam, the similar question we ask. But we will rapidly go on mainly the examination, investigations and treatment part. And whatever question you ask, okay, if they can't answer, we will have to answer them. And I at see. The end, if there is, you feel that any theory part is left behind, okay, you can ask them and you can complete the subject.
Fine, sir. One more, just one more query, sir. Jaise, sir, in history, history, sometime they miss anything. So can I interrupt and just
correct them? See, now it is like this. You know, there are two parts. Last 2 years, the examination scenario has changed. The pattern has changed. There is more of OSCE. And not only that, because, you know, the patient's physical examination was not there, they used to give us a case scenario, right? And with that, they used to give the questions also, the fixed questions.
Okay, sir.
We don't know in next exam the same pattern will be there or not. So as per our old pattern only, we will go ahead. So as you are saying very rightly, if they miss something in history or you want to suggest, please, you go ahead.
We will correct. We will correct it. Okay, fine.
Okay. I think then we should start now.
Yes, sir, I will start.
Yes, Achin. Gita sir has already joined, na?
Gita sir has joined.
Hiren is also there.
Yes.
Dr. Maheshwari, I don't know when he is joining.
He will be joining soon, Madam Masaji.
Okay. Fine.
Should I start, sir?
Yeah, please start.
A Muslim gentleman, 33 years of age, shopkeeper, resident of Mumbai, came with complaints of right scrotal swelling since 3 months.
Yes. So Abhishek and Imtiaz, this is the main history. So in this scrotal, the history is that he has got a scrotal swelling since last 3 months. So what are the questions you want to ask?
Sir, first of all, I'd like to know the onset duration and the progress of the swelling. How did it come about? Was it insidious in onset? Was it associated with any incident which made or did it follow some incident after which the patient noticed the swelling? Sir, what is the duration since 3 months? It's already there, sir. What is the progress of the swelling? Has it been rapidly progressing or not? Or how has it been? Yes, sir. And the progress. And other than that, sir, the increase or decrease in size associated with lying down or, sir, lying down or standing up, any change with coughing, sir, any relation, any associated symptom like pain, sir, scrotal heaviness, loss of scrotal sensation, or, sir, any vague discomfort like that, sir, any history of trauma after which the swelling appeared, sir, or any history of fever, dysuria, or, sir, fever, dysuria, or previous history of UTI after which the swelling appeared, sir. Other than that, sir, first of all, sir, any other swelling, whether the patient noticed in the contralateral side or not. And, sir, other than that, sir, any swelling in the abdomen, sir, whether it appeared or not. If there is, sir, then does it have any associated symptoms like lower limb edema or, sir, flank pain or sir, any GI symptoms like that, sir. And other than that, sir, negative history in the form of, sir, history of chest pain, breathlessness, hemoptysis, something, sir, or more than that. And then following after that, sir, past history, sir, in past history, like to find out, sir, any history of LUTS associated with dysuria. That all I've asked already. Any history of trauma, previous, earlier trauma, sir? Any history of undescended testes, sir? Did he have any history of undescended testes for which he was operated in the childhood, sir? And thereafter, sir, in furthermore, any past history of diabetes, TB, or, sir, filariasis, whether if he had, sir? Or other than
Abhishek,
that, sir,
before you go to the personal history and other things,
yes, sir.
What I noticed is you asked all the details of the negative history. But I would say that just, you know, make a compartment in your mind.
Right, sir.
What I mean to say is that questions related to benign swellings and questions related to malignant swellings.
Okay, sir.
Huh? Like you asked fever, dysuria, then suddenly you went to, malignant, you know, history related to malignancy.
Yes.
So why don't you divide it into benign and malignant? So it will be compartmentalized in your brain.
Okay, sir.
And it will help you because jumping from here to there, don't do that. You are very much correct in asking all the negative history. But you ask negative history related to benign swellings like trauma, dysuria, epididymal orchitis, blah, blah, hernia, whatever you want.
Right, sir.
Then you go to malignant swellings. Okay?
Okay, sir.
That way it will be much better.
Okay, sir.
Abhishek, your thinking is very good. And, you know, I can understand that after asking all these questions, you will, systemize all the answers. So that's a very good thing. Imtiaz, you want to add anything?
Sir, I think he has covered almost all the things. Yeah. I want to ask about, is there any history of flank pain, backache is there? Any history of cough, hemoptysis, respiratory distress? I would like to ask that. Similar history in the family. If there is any similar history in the family, father or brother is affected by the same problem.
Why you want to ask that history?
Sir, it is a family tendency to occur in the family member.
If what?
Suppose suppose we are suspecting a testicular malignancy, father is suffering from the same disease, there is an increased risk of the disease in the kids, or a brother has a history of testicular malignancy, the patient will be at increased risk of developing the testicular malignancy.
What is the increased rate?
Sir, if father is affected...
Then what are the chances that son will get?
Sir, it will be about four to six times. If father is affected, if brother is affected, almost 8 to 12
approximately
times.
10 to 12 times.
Okay. And what is the importance of any history of intended cases, operation done?
Sir, the history... Yes.
Cryptorchidism is a risk factor for the development of germ cell tumor in the testes. So such history we'll have to ask to the patient. And at what age this orchidopaxy has been done, that is also important.
So tell us now everything in detail about that.
Ideally, orchidopaxy should be done before the first birth day. Means within the first year, 6 to 12 months, orchidopaxy should be done. Thereafter, there is an increased risk of malignancy. They say this antecedent testes, there is a risk around 4 to 6 times is the relative risk of developing the malignancy in the testes. If we do orchidopaxy before puberty, this risk can be reduced to 2 to 3 times.
So that is one thing. Second, if you do early orchidopaxy, then what are the chances of spermatogenesis? It improves?
Yes, sir, that will be also preserved if we do the early orchidopaxy.
Some background sound is there. Okay. What else? Someone is talking behind. Can you just find out?
Kaushalendra, I think some Kaushalendra is there.
Okay.
Sir, moreover, I'd add to like in the family history whether he is married and whether he has completed his family or not, sir.
Very good. That's true.
So history of infertility is important.
I was asking you that if you do the surgery, does it have any importance?
Sir, it might affect the fertility, sir.
No, that's okay. Suppose if you have done the surgery,
yes,
for orchidopaxy, and then later on patient develops malignancy, Is there any difference between this and a person who has got a normal testes and develops a malignancy?
Sir, cryptorchid testis is more prone to malignancy. That's the only thing I know, sir.
So that is one that you answered. But suppose you have operated that patient. Later on, he develops malignancy in that testis. Will the management change? And if it changes, then why?
It's the opposite side malignancy, sir.
See, if you have operated a patient for undescended testes, okay, you have done orchidopexy. Now he develops malignancy in that testes.
Yes, sir.
Then your approach will differ or it will remain the same?
Yes, sir. We'll have to take care of the inguinal and iliac nodes also because lymphatic drainage will be altered.
Yeah. So that is what I wanted to know. Fine. Jite, sir, you want to ask? Mahendra, now your turn. Please.
Yeah. So, maybe Gita sir will ask something like that. I can ask.
In spite of asking, I may make them to take the history. Like whenever there is the case of a testicular swelling is there, so your approach to the testicular swelling. Testicular swelling, it is either infective, it is either anatomical, or it is either malignant. So infective, it is epididymitis or it is arthritis. Anatomical, it may be varicocele, it may be hematoma, it may be pyoceles, it may be hermatoceles. So these are some anatomical examples. And infective, again, it is germ cell and non-germ cell tumor. Again, plastic cell, germ cell tumor, seminoma, non-seminoma, non-germ cell, Leydig cell tumor, some miscellaneous tumor, Sertoli cell tumor, plastic, it's in bad mejanga. So you, when asking the history, the first chief complaint you have to elaborate chief complaint in 2-3 lines. After elaborating the chief complaint, whatever the diagnosis you have judged in your mind, so you have to rule out one by asking the negative question. Okay. So first, if you are suspecting epididymal market, so any relation to the any history suggests that epididymal market is means what? Chlorine retraction, any urethral discharge. Any history of old patient, any history of sexual transmitted disease. This is related to any history of urethral pain. This is related to the infection. Again, the congenital some causes like undescended testes, history of surgery in the child, then undescended testes, family mein abhi tak jana nahi, lekin undescended testes ke baad mein दूसरा रहेगा और मेरे कल से मैलिग्नेंसी की तरफ अगर जाना है मैलिग्नेंसी में तुमको हिस्ट्री रिलेटेड टू द टेस्टिकुलर स्वेलिंग हिस्ट्री रिलेटेड टू द लोकली एडवांस्ड लिम्फेटिक मेजोरिटी ऑफ द मैलिग्नेंसी एक्सेप्ट फॉर योर कार्सिनोमा इनिशियली वेंट मेटास्टेसाइज टू द लिम्फेटिक फर्स्ट एंड लेटर ऑन वैस्कुलर सो फॉर योर कार्सिनोमा मेजोरिटी थ्रू द वैस्कुलर सो लिम्फ नोड एंड फर्स्ट स्टेशन Where is the first station? Abdominal lymph. Then gynecomastia. Left supraclavicular lymph node. Crossover from right to left, right side lymph, left side lymph. Right side crossover is possible, but left side crossover is not possible. Then inguinal node. How about inguinal node? Blockage of the abdominal nodes or lymphatic and retrograde filling and towards the inguinal node. Of iliac node. Inguinal node is due to the local extension of or any surgery or the scrotum. Then metastasis. Metastasis, lymph node, lung, bone, common metastasis. So, choriocarcinoma, major is in the lung. Rest of the things is either in the lymph node or bone. So, history ruling out all this lung metastasis means of expectoration, chest pain, mediastinal mass, the dyspnea, then abdominal mass, lump in abdomen. Lump in left supraclavicular area, then any compression symptoms, lower limb edema, renal failure, then backache, then gynecomastia, and all. He has asked the majority of the symptoms, but categorically he has to fits into one diagnosis. So that if you tell you 1, 2, 3, 4, so for example, chest pain, dyspnea, cup, then I am examiner, I will look, he is ruling out some chest involvement in that particular disease, whatever he is expecting after listening the question. So Abhishek has asked majority of the questions, but he can improve by adding such things in his system.
Fine. Mahendra, you want to add anything?
Yes, sir. Just a few lines that Hiren Bhai or Geeta sir has summarized this very well, and how to structure the history as per the your different diagnosis comes in your mind after seeing any origin of origin of a disease. When we see about the malignancy part, in spite of all the benign thing, only few risk factor history that we should ask about the infertility, the tumor diseases syndrome, hypospadias, and the family history. These four risk factors normally are linked with the guide us towards the malignancy as well as the painless swelling in the abdomen, which is not necessary with the any trauma and other things. Only these things that I wanted to add.
Oh, very good. Fine. Okay. Achin, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Patient was apparently asymptomatic 3 months back when he noticed gradual enlargement of right scrotum, insidious in onset, progressive in nature with swelling not changing in size with change of posture and cuffing, associated with pain, dull aching in nature, continuous type, radiating to right groin, aggravated by movement on or prolonged standing, relieved by taking rest, lying down, and by medication.
Go ahead.
No history of trauma, no history of any fever, no history of burning, micturition, hematuria, no history of lower urinary tract symptoms, no history of weight loss, cough, hemoptysis or dyspnea, no history of similar swelling in the opposite testis, no history of similar complaints in family, no history of undescended testis in past.
Fine. So Imtiaz, whenever you come across, see, we are doing now urology, a super specialty. Whenever you come across the swelling in the scrotal region, what are the differential diagnoses that will come to your mind? So you are sitting in an OPD and the patient comes with such a swelling. So what is the differential diagnosis in your mind?
Sir, cupidigmal orchite, testicular malignancy.
You mean what you will think when you are seeing it. And then you can add on when you are writing a theory. Okay?
Yes, sir. Cupidigmal orchite, testicular malignancy, hydrocele.
What is the commonest when the patient comes to you with the swelling in the scrotal region? What is the commonest?
Sir, cupidigmal orchite, sir.
That is common or something else is common?
Hydrocele is common.
Hydrocele, sir.
Hydrocele. Punica vaginal is hydrocele. That is the commonest thing. Yeah?
Yes, sir.
So there is one. Second?
Hernia.
Okay, but
yes,
fine. Then?
Then testicular malignancies.
Yeah, you said epidermal orchitis,
yes,
torsion and?
Yes, sir. Testicular torsion, then
malignancy, or sometimes it can be epididymal cyst.
Epididymal cyst, infected hydrocele, organized hematoma, hematocele, supermetocele.
Okay. So basically, there are only 5 or 6 types of swelling which comes in your mind, correct?
Yes, sir.
So one is a tunica vaginalis hydrocele, or it can be a big epididymal cyst. Second is, as you said, epidermal orchitis, torsion, malignancy, then complete hernia, varicocele, lipoma of the cord, or maybe congenital hydrocele of the cord. I think this is more than enough. So now how we'll go about? Abhishek, now next what?
Yes, sir. After completing the history, I'd go ahead with examination, sir. Examination, local examination will include, first of all, general examination, sir. In general examination, I would look for the performance status of the patient, sir. Performance status, nutrition, sir, any edema, sir, lower limb edema, or, sir, any... yes, sir. Yes, sir. And then, sir, moving on to the local examination, sir, examine the genitalia, sir, in that specifically.
No,
in
no,
the
no.
Student,
sir. Abhishek, general yes, examination means from top to bottom. So if you are expecting something in the bottom, the scrotum, that if you are expecting malignancy, if you are expecting, suppose malignancy, so what are the things to be seen? From the neck to abdomen, generally it can okay. be seen, na?
Yes, sir. So, sir, supraclavicular fullness
yes.
or swelling, sir?
Neck swelling, it can be gynecomastia can be seen.
Gynecomastia, yes, sir.
Bleeding,
true, sir.
Bleeding gums can be seen. Testicular deposit reh sakte ya AML reh sakta hai. के बाद में थोड़ा सा नीचे आ गया तो abdominal mass रह सकता है और थोड़ा सा नीचे आ गया तो inguinal mass रह सकता है inguinal lymph node रह सकते हैं
okay,
ये general examination में सब कुछ चीजें दिखती है तो ये general examination में ये बोलना है examiner को लगेगा कि आप वो intent से या वो चीज आपके दिमाग में चल रही है अगर आप suspect कर रहे हैं malignancy तो
right sir
fine okay Achin go ahead
Yes. Sir, past history, no comorbidities, no history of any previous surgeries, family history, married, two children, no history of similar complaints in family members in past, personal history, sir, diet non-vegetarian, appetite adequate, bowel bladder regular, sleep undisturbed, habits non-alcoholic, non-smoker, non-tobacco chore.
Okay. So, Imtiaz, which are the syndromes related to malignancy, testicular malignancy?
Sir, Klinefelter syndrome and Down syndrome, sir.
Okay, fine. So now, yes, Achin, go ahead.
Sir, general examination, patient is conscious, cooperative, well oriented to time, place and person, moderately built and nourished. Pulse is 80 beats per minute, BP is 110 by 80, respiratory rate is 20 cycles per minute, afebrile, SpO2 is 98% on room air, BMI is 22 kg per meter square, no evidence of any pyloric torus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy or edema, head to toe and spine examination is grossly normal.
Yeah. So Abhishek, next.
Sir, moving
which
on
are the important egg. General, you, I want to know what are the most important things in general examination you like to see?
Sir, any lump or fullness seen in the supraclavicular region, sir, any fullness seen in the abdomen, sir, any fullness like Geeta sir said in the inguinal region, sir, and mm-hmm. other than that, any lower limb edema, sir, if it is there. Hmm. And sir, general performance status is also important, sir. If yes, sir. And other than that,
auscultation of chest, sir.
Auscultation of chest that will come in auscultation.
Okay, fine.
Karnofsky score of this patient is 100.
Sorry, sir.
I'm telling about regarding performance status.
Okay.
Yeah. So now this is your completed general examination. So MTS next what?
Sir, we'll go for the local examination. First of all, on inspection, we'll see.
Yes, sir. Achin, show
yes,
them.
Local exam, sir. Sir,
no. That let them answer. No. Yeah. Yes, MTS.
Sir. There is a scrotal swelling. Involving right hemiscrotum, left chest is almost involving whole of the scrotum, left chest is pushed laterally. Pinched, I could not see properly. The skin overlying the swelling looks normal in color. There are no visible, there is no scrotal edema. The skin looks non-edematous.
There is
a swelling occupying the right hemiscrotum, sir. The swelling appears single in number. It cannot be seen separately from the testes. The skin overlying the swelling is unremarkable, sir. No scar, sinuses or dilated veins, at least anteriorly. And other than that, sir, I would also want to see, change in the size of swelling with lying down. Sir, the upper superior border of the swelling appears distinct, sir. And other than that, the left hemiscrotum appears unremarkable, sir. there is loss of rugosity seen on the right hemiscrotum, sir.
Yeah. While describing any swelling, there is a fixed protocol. You have to go by that. State examiner say, I don't want to listen to this. Just tell me what is your positive point. Okay, so what does this? Size, shape, surface, edges, margins, borders, consistency, tenderness, transfluency to get above the swelling, secondary fluctuation. ये सब चीजें बोलना है.
Sir, this I mentioned only on inspection, sir. Moving on to palpation, sir. Sir, yes. The inspectory.
You forget what is smooth surface, right?
Sir, I would mention that on palpation, sir. Appears smooth, yes, sir. True, sir.
Appears smooth. So as Gita sir said, absolutely. Das, you should read Das for describing all the swelling, ulcer, everything. Okay.
Okay,
sir. Yeah, you cannot escape there. Skip that.
If the examiner feels na ki you don't want to listen, he will tell you, go ahead, go ahead. If you have any interest, tell your positive point.
Right, sir. They will get bored.
Okay. Now next, Abhishek. Next what?
Sir, moving on to the palpatory findings, sir, the inspectory findings are confirmed. And sir, in palpation, sir, the number of the swelling and the association with the testis is found out, sir. The skin overlying the swelling, whether it is attached to the swelling or not. Any sensations associated with, is it painful to touch, sir, or any loss of scrotal sensations?
Normal testis, sir.
True, sir. First of all, though, we'll palpate normal testes. True, sir. I missed that.
Yes. Fine. See, first you will palpate the normal testes, and second thing, first of all, you will find out whether he has got any tenderness or not. Only after that you will do the proper examination.
Sir, may I ask one question? Why should the normal testes should palpate first than the diseased one?
Answer, Abhishek. Intyas.
We can check the sensation of the testes, normal, this consistency of the testes, we can palpate so that we can compare the abnormal side with the normal one.
For comparison,
you can compare with these two in such big mass? And how will you check the testes sensation? What is it? Many times people say that, but what is it?
Normally, testes is highly sensitive word.
What is sensitive? Please tell.
Testes is normally a highly sensitive organ, but in malignancy, these testicular sensations are lost.
Always? No, I think you don't know. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can answer.
Yeah. So what happened? Testicular anatomy. If you see from the rete testis, the nerves and vessels all enters into the testis, right?
Right, sir.
So only when this rete testis is involved by the tumor and this destroyed at the that level, only then you will not get the sensation. And this sensation means when we press or palpate the testis, patient will feel pain in the abdomen, right? So this is called as a sensation. Not you are touching the skin over the scrotum. So skin is sensitive, not the testis.
Yeah.
So whenever in exam you use any term, you should know what are you saying. If you don't know in this simple word sensation, examiner can catch you. Okay.
Yes, Abhishek, understood.
Yes. Got it, yes, sir.
Yeah, so be careful whatever you are saying. It's a common thing we used, but this is the logic behind when you say this thing. Okay?
Got it, sir.
And in exam, if you palpate testicular too hard for sensation, what will happen?
Tumor patient might be disseminated.
Patient may develop vasovagal attack.
Oh, yes, sir.
Okay? So be careful when you are eliciting this test. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Gita sir, anything you want to add, Gorang sir?
No. Now let see. Because sometimes the examiner may have taken MBBS and MS exams, and now he has come for urology. So for them, this is very important. Just to remember, So I wanted to know how they will, what is the this thing, what are the different tests, and what is an importance, and when they are negative. Just in brief. So Abhishek, can you tell us?
Sir, fluctuation test, transelimination.
What is the fluctuation? What is the principle behind that?
Sir, the principle behind fluctuation is that when pressure is applied to a cavity filled with fluid, sir, it is equally distributed all along the cavity
and
in which the fluid is contained.
And pressure
exerted to the wall.
So it is Pascal's law, which says the pressure
Pascal's law, yes, sir,
anywhere upon the mass of the liquid is equally transmitted in all directions.
All directions.
And x perpendicular to the surface. So this is the principle, correct? So now, how will you elicit it?
Sir, with the help of the index finger and the middle finger of both hands, sir, the testis is held at the superior and the inferior poles. And with the help of the thumb, sir, the pressure is applied over the scrotum, sir, and the distribution of the thrill is to be felt on the index and the middle finger, sir. That is fluctuation test, sir.
So first of all, you have to fix the testes and you have to make it tight.
Yes, sir.
Okay? Tense. You have to make it little tense. Otherwise, yes, you cannot elicit it. So that is the most important. Okay? So,
right, sir.
Which are the, when it will be negative?
Tense. If the hydrocele is tense or it is thickened wall is there, calcified wall.
So can you start from outside, from the skin to testes? Can you go?
Yes, sir.
Quick.
A thickened edematous skin.
Like in filaria. Okay. Yes, second.
Sir. Yes, sir. Calcified wall of the hydrocele. Tense hydrocele.
Calcified. No. Please. You are now MCH. Doing MCH and DNB. So you have to answer it properly. Calcified what?
Calcified hydrocele wall, sir.
Hydrocele wall? What is hydrocele wall called?
Tunica, sir. Tunica vaginalis, sir.
Tunica, what is meant by hydrocele?
Yeah.
What
answer,
is meant by hydrocele?
Yes, sir. Sir, it is hydrocele is accumulation of fluid within the tunica vaginalis, sir.
So what are the three layers of testis?
Tunica vasculosa, tunica albuginea, and tunica vaginalis, sir.
Which is innermost?
Tunica vasculosa, sir.
That is attached to the testis.
Yes, sir.
The connection is between the
tunica albuginea and tunica vaginalis, sir.
Correct.
So okay, go ahead. So what are the things you said? Thickened skin, like in filaria. Thickened sac, calcified sac. Okay. Third, thickened fluid, like pyocele or
hematocele. Yes, sir.
Or chylocele, correct?
Yes, sir.
Chyle is there. Okay. Then yes, it is very tense. And
yes,
fluid is very less. And testis is enlarged. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, what is the principle of transelimination and when it is negative?
So the principle of transillumination is based on, I think, the Tyndall effects are wherein the path of light shown on a colloidal solution is seen along the colloidal solution itself. So, sir, on that principle for transillumination, sir, the transillumination is noted by a hollow pipe onto the anterior surface of the testis wherein the of the scrotum wherein the light is shined from the lateral side of the testis, sir, as in.
Opposite and exactly opposite side you will see, right?
Opposite side, yes, sir.
Yeah. So you will ask the patient to hold the testes because with one hand you are going to put a torch and from another hand you are going to put a tube of to see.
Yes, sir.
So when it is negative?
Sir, in pyocele, it will be negative, sir.
Same thing.
Sorry, sir. From inside to outside, outside to inside, sir. The very thickened wall of thickened skin, sir, in that it will be negative, sir. Any calcified tunica vaginalis, sir, it will be negative, sir. It will be negative in when the in Kyle in this thing, sir. Kylosil, sir, where
and Kylosil, yes.
Kylosil and Pyrosil, yes, sir.
Just say like that, because normally these are not going to be asked, but some examiner may ask you. So we have to just.
So generally in local examination, the bottom line is major except choriocarcinoma. In rest of the testicular tumor, test is general. It's not the rule, but this is usually. On filling, the testis is nodular, firm to hard consistency. Hydrocele is, if at all present, it is secondary hydrocele.
Yes.
So examiner may ask you what is primary, what is secondary, how will you differentiate? So transluminescence is negative and lax skin over the scrotum in case of the secondary hydrocele, dense skin over the scrotum and transluminescence is the primary hydrocele. Then loss of testicular skin, already you have discussed, and flat and difficult to palpate the epididymis. These are the usual findings in a local examination of a case of test term.
Okay.
Okay. Fine. Okay, Achin, go ahead.
Sir, local examination, patient examined in supine position with implied informed consent with exposure from nipple to knee in adequate room light in standing position. Inspectory findings are solitary right scrotal swelling, roughly around 8 to 6 cm inside, ovoid in shape, with loss of normal scrotal rugosity with well-defined edges. Right testis cannot be separately identified from the above swelling. No cough impulse, non-pulsatile, non-peristaltic. Palpation, sir, no local rise of temperature and tenderness. Smooth surface, firm to hard in consistency. Right testis not separately palpable. Getting up the swelling is possible. No fluctuation, no transformation, non-pulsatile, not fixed to overlying scale, non-compressible and non-reducible. The exact size of the swelling is 8 by 6 centimeters, sir. Opposite test is normal. Penis is grossly normal and all hernial orifices are normal, sir.
Fine. So Abhishek, now this is a thing. What else you want to know?
Sir, I would also want to do an abdominal examination, sir, to rule out any lump in the abdomen. And yes.
Okay, Achin, anything else?
Yes, sir.
Any other positive finding?
No, sir. All other findings are no abnormality detected.
So, Abhishek, this is a fine. These are the findings. Now, what do you want to do?
Yes, sir. So, sir, after this, on systemic examination is also unremarkable, sir. And
yeah.
I would also auscultate the chest, sir, to see for any finding there, sir. And considering all that normal, sir, then I would like to go ahead and evaluate the patients. I would like to do some basic investigations first.
What is your provisional diagnosis?
Sir, provisional diagnosis on the basis of history appears to be my first provisional diagnosis would be a testicular malignancy, sir. Second will be epididymo orchitis, sir. And
it is painless, na?
It is pain. He has some pain, sir.
Okay.
Why not? It is first hydrocele and second malignancy. My first malignancy.
Sir, because it is hard, sir, on examination, it is hard, sir. And fluctuation, transillumination are negative, sir.
Okay, fine.
Can it be organized hematoma?
It can be, sir. But there is no history of trauma, sir.
Okay.
So, how will you proceed?
Sir, then further, I would like to evaluate the patient, sir, with some, apart from the routine investigations, I would like to do some basic investigations, which would include an ultrasound of the scrotum and tumor markers, sir. And also a urine routine and culture sensitivity, sir.
Achin, show them.
part of telling urine routine and culture in one go. CBC urine routine examination some random blood sugar renal function test liver function test one go mein agar blood nikal hi rahe ho to basic laboratory investigation plus some diagnostic.
Yes sir, I mentioned diagnostic, apart from the routine
yeah ultrasound and whatever you are marker you are told also.
Yes.
The basic investigation include hemoglobin 13.1, total count 9000, serum creatinine 0.71, INR 1.1, PT 12.1 second, APTT 22 seconds.
Fine. What else? Show them ultrasonography. Yeah. One of you can comment on this. Imtiaz?
Yes, sir. There is a hypoechoic, multiple hypoechoic lesions are seen in testes with well maintained border.
No, the testis itself is enlarged, sir, and there are multiple hypoechoic shadows seen. And other than that, rest I can't make out, sir.
Can you see some cystic areas inside?
Sir, I am not sure whether to call it a hypoechoic area or like call it cystic directly, sir. I mean,
whatever it is, so you are able to see that, huh?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Ajay, please read the report.
Sir, findings are suggestive of there are evidence of marked enlargement of right testicle with complete loss of normal architecture and echo texture. There are multiple small to moderate size cystic lesions with low medium internal echoes within them, and normal blood flow is seen on color Doppler study. Findings are suggestive of traumatic enlarged right testicle with areas of local hemorrhage within right testicle with bilateral varicose.
Abhishek, now, what is your diagnosis? Post-traumatic?
Sir, this may be a case of post-traumatic hematocele with post-traumatic organized hematocele, sir.
Imtiaz, what is your...
Sir, there is no history of trauma.
There is, of course.
By knowing the ultrasound report, is malignancy ruled out?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Okay. So what next?
We'd like to evaluate the patient with further investigation, sir. We'd like to
what
do serum tumor marker, sir, we'd like to do.
Okay. Achin, show them.
Beta HCG 478.2, alpha fetoprotein is 56.38, LDH is 76.5.
Bolo bhai.
Fetoprotein is rate.
Okay, Imtiaz.
Yes, sir.
You tell me what is the importance of each of these? How it is going to help you in making your diagnosis, in prognosis, and in your treatment?
Yes, sir. Serum tumor markers can give us idea about the diagnosis of the disease, and depending upon the level of the tumor markers, we can get idea about the prognosis of the disease. But staging of the disease, we'll have to do post surgery only. We have to repeat the serum tumor markers and stage the disease accordingly, sir.
But
so,
now
tell us everything. First, tell us about beta HCG. Then talk about. See, Mahendra is there. He will help you out now. But you tell us about what is, suppose if there is a short note or you get a question in exam about a tumor markers in testicular malignancy, how you are going to elaborate?
Sir,
First, talk about beta-HCG, talk about what is phyto, alpha-phytoprotein, what is the importance of LDH, then in which conditions it will be raised, where it is, when it will not be raised, what is the prognosis on that.
Beta-HCG will be mainly raised in...
Mahindra is there, Mahindra will guide you.
Before you go into the details of the tumor markers, I would like to make a comment. I'm really happy, Imtiaz, that you asked for the tumor markers. This is one malignancy wherein we don't need any biopsy or anything. We can just do the tumor markers. So never get carried away with the ultrasound report, which is showing, you know, the ultrasound people have a habit of putting a comment below. Do this, do that. And it's suggestive of hematoma, maybe trauma. So you used your brain and you asked for the tumor markers. That was a very good move.
Agreed.
Yeah, so go ahead.
Sir, beta HCG, it will be mainly raised in choriocarcinoma and some seminomas. About 15% of the seminoma beta HCG will be raised. Alpha-phytoprotein, it will be raised mainly in yolk sac tumor and embryonal cell carcinoma. While as LDH, it is non-specific, but it just gives us the burden of the disease.
Mahendra, you want to just teach them here? We will be very happy.
Yeah. So, first off, you should know what is the origin of each these markers. Trophoblastic cells, cis-trophoblastic cells, beta-HCG and the alpha-phytoprotein. So, as a general rule, just I wanted to say, if alpha-phytoprotein is raised, okay, it cannot be seminoma. Okay, just general rule, you should know about that. As you said, beta-HCG can be raised in seminoma, but AFP cannot be raised in seminoma. There must be a component of non-seminoma germ cell tumors. And as you know, the most common, the variety of NGC is mixed germ cell tumor. Mix. This is not normally we don't find pure yolk sac, pure embryonal, maybe pure teratoma, pure seminoma we can find. Very, very difficult to find pure embryonal carcinoma, pure yolk cell carcinoma. Okay, Imtiaz?
Yes,
so sir. This is the, and about the clinical, this thing, prognostication value, so you should know about the S1, S2, and S3. Okay?
Yes, sir.
What is called S1, what is called S3, or S2 and S3. So that level of S1, S2, S3 relate with the prognostic and the staging of the testicular cancer.
Yes, sir.
So when Dr. Gaurang Shah sir asked you this question and whatever input Mahendra Bhai has given you, I feel that such a question should be answered very systematically. What is the tumor marker? Which are the normal tissue which excrete that? What is the half-life? In which conditions it is raised? Which malignancies it is diagnostic? How is it used as a prognostic tool? What is the staging, S1, S2, S3? All these things should come. You cannot just make two or three comments and then stop there. Let the examiner stop you. Sorry, Mahendra Bhai.
Hiran Bhai said, the T half of each markers is very important because it will guide you the response of the treatment and maybe the disease recurrence. Okay? So suppose that if you plan for oophorectomy in this patient, so do you know the half-life of beta-HCG, AFP and LDH?
Yes, sir. So beta-HCG half-life is 24 to 48 hours. For AFP, it is, sir, 3 to 7 days. And, sir, LDH, it is approximately 2 to 3 days.
So just mathematically, you remember that serum PSA and AFP has the same TR value, 5 to 7 days.
Okay.
So you will never forget this thing, the T half of these two, AFP and the PSA. They both have the half-life of 5 to 7 days. And you correctly said, beta-HCG about 2 to 3 days and LDH also 2 to 3 days. Okay?
Right, sir.
Yeah. And as you correctly say, LDH has only test the disease burden. In reality, it doesn't have any distinction with the tumor progression, and this only recurrence it can disease teratoma or something other than NGCT, then it also indicative of disease recurrence, right
sir.
So my next question is, patient in ultrasonography, the testis is normal, it is only homogeneous mass in last testis with hematoma, right? So why these markers are raised?
Uh,
Yes, Imtiaz.
Yes, sir.
Logical answer.
Patient can have a disease that is advanced or
burnt out.
Sir, intratesticular germ cell tumor, intratesticular germ cell neoplasia, sir.
Intratesticular. But USG shows no mass in the sonography.
Maybe sometimes it can be burnt out primary.
Burnt out primary. What reason? Auto burnt out or after chemotherapy, something like that.
Auto burnt out.
Normally, how common you see that? Why did you think about the extragonadal germ cell tumors?
Yes, sir.
Right? The answer of this question is, okay, if testes are normal and markers are raised, the most site is the extra germ cell,
extragonadal
site.
Extragonadal
site.
Right.
So yes. Can I go to the report of this one, sonography? I just want to make some point. Yeah. The imaging. So if you see the testicular, it is a homogeneous architecture with the some cystic lesion, but the cystics are not smooth and smooth wall. There can also be necrosis, right?
Yes, sir.
So always if you have a doubt, always have a USG done by the experienced the sonologist, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Fine. So Mahendra, you want to talk anything about anything more about the tumor markers?
No, sir. We will after the staging. We say staging is remaining. Let us finish the staging. It is remaining.
So with this tumor marker, what is your probable diagnosis? Can you judge one or two diagnoses?
Sir, it's mixed germ cell tumor, sir. Non-seminomatous germ cell.
Okay. Because there is table in the chamber. You should mug up that table. This raise, that raise, this diagnosis, that increase, this increase, that diagnosis. So, pakka paath karke rakhna. Push sakte. If it is only beta SCG is raised, then what are the possibilities? Majority chances it is choriocarcinoma. Embryonal cell carcinoma.
Embryonal.
10-15% chance of seminoma. Only if alpha pseudo protein is raised, it will raise out. It will rule out the pure seminoma and choriocarcinoma rule out. So, basta jo bhi hai, wo alpha pseudo protein. And LTH is always for the bulk of the disease. And advanced seminoma. So this is not the confirmatory, but it is just a clue towards some time.
And fine. Also, you should know the normal value of these markers. Normal value.
Yes. So Abhishek, what are the normal value?
Sir, beta HCG. Sir, in females and males, it is different, sir. I think less than 500 in males, sir. And
no,
I'm not able to recall.
Yeah, you know,
I'm not sure, sir.
Or 10 milli international unit per ml. So this is normal for male. Beta is
less than
10 milli international unit per ml or less than 1 nanogram per ml. Dono isme bata raha hu, nanogram ka bhi bata raha hu, milli international unit per less than 1 nanogram per ml or 10 milli international unit per ml.
And alpha fetoprotein
bolo,
think sir, 10, sir.
Yeah,
10 nanogram.
It's 10 to 12, something.
Okay.
What is the half-life of beta subunit?
Yes, sir.
what is half life of beta subunit of human chorionic gonad trap?
24 to 48 hours.
Half life is 24 hour probably.
24 to 48 hours.
Beta subunit ka kitna half life?
Okay. Mahendra, you want to add anything?
No, sir. I think Gitte sir has elaborated everything about the pathology and with how to find out the guess the pathology based on the tumor markers. And I think just to show you the staging next, what did you do?
Okay, now. So next one, Abhishek. Now these are the, so what is your diagnosis now?
Sir, it appears to be a non-seminomatous germ cell tumor, sir.
No, forget about histopathology.
Sir, mix, mix.
Give us a clinical diagnosis now. So what you are suspecting? You're suspecting non-malignant tumor, pathology or malignant?
Malignant pathology, sir.
Malignant pathology. So now next what? So you are suspecting that it is the CATST, correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So now next what? What do you want to do now?
Sir, then furthermore, I would like to evaluate the abdomen and the chest by doing a CT. Sir, a CT scan.
Do ultrasonography or do you want to do CT?
No, sir. Contrast and CT scan will be more definitive.
Okay. Imtiaz, you want to do that first or you want to do something else?
I would like to get tissue diagnosis, sir. I want to confirm the disease by getting the tissue diagnosis. We'd like to do orchiectomy, a radical orchiectomy.
Which one? What do you like to do?
A radical orchiectomy.
Both are same? Radical orchiectomy, yes, and high orchiectomy?
Yes, sir.
Mahendra, I'm not aware of this.
Sir, it is a interchangeable word. But the terms are used for the both things. Some people use radical and some people use this one, high inguinal orchiectomy.
Okay. So then fair enough.
Yeah.
Fine.
But why do you want to do HIO first, then the proper staging? What is the harm of doing a CT scan before, or what is the benefit of doing CT scan after the high inguinal orchiectomy?
We'll have to study the disease after we get the tissue diagnosis. We'll have to repeat the serum tumor markers and we'll have to do the CT scan to study the disease accordingly.
So that means if tumor markers become normal, then we will not do CT scan.
No, sir. We have to keep the patient in follow-up even if the tumor markers become normal.
What after you will do after 3 months CT scan then?
No, sir. A baseline CT scan is required at the time of diagnosis, sir.
So when we like to do? After the orchiectomy or before the orchiectomy?
Before the orchiectomy, sir.
Now you said we will do orchiectomy first. So when in CA testis, something is approach is something different. When you have a markers, you cannot do orchiectomy before the markers in your hand when you have a doubt of testicular cancer. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Right. So always staging should be first in management of malignancy. Okay. Staging should be first, at least in testicular cancer. Okay.
Right, sir.
Yeah. It will give you proper idea and the burden of disease that will correlate with the tumor markers.
So in this case, whether CT scan should be done first before orchiectomy, or
yes,
it should be done after?
Sir, before, sir. Better to do before, sir.
Before. Correct. Yeah. So that, see, they should know it in exam that
yes,
what is the right. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Fine. Okay. So now, Achin, show them.
Okay.
This is the exit chest. Yeah. Just see, Abhishek, see it properly.
So, Abhishek, what will be the area of interest here in this CT scan?
Sir, the retroperitoneal area around the great vessel, sir.
Why? Why retroperitoneal? Testicles are in the scrotum and they are lymphatic drainage in the inguinal area.
Sir, testicular malignancy, the first station, first echelon of drainage is the retroperitoneal lymph node, sir.
Why? CA penis has the inguinal node as a first drainage area.
Yes, sir.
So being a genitals, why see a testicular this thing cancer will have first station at the retroperitoneum?
Abhishek, you are right, but you have to justify that.
Sir, the embryology development of testis is different from that of the penis and the scrotum, sir. So it comes, it develops from the retroperitoneum, sir. So hence the first echelon is retroperitoneal, sir.
Yeah, so your answer should be the origin of germ cells in from the retroperitoneum, and they drag with this thing, the lymphatics and the blood vessels, okay?
Okay, sir.
From retroperitoneum to the scrotum.
Right.
So that's why the first station is the retroperitoneum, okay?
Right.
And this is the, again, reason when you press the testis, the sensation you first felt in the abdomen, not in the testis, okay?
Right.
Yeah. Okay, good. Now, can you just describe?
Sir,
One more thing, I should advise you people learn how to describe CT scan in the examination, CT scan. Okay? Whether it is a renal mass, it is a bladder mass, it is a prostatic cancer, whatever, or maybe some benign disease, you should know how to describe the CT scan. So can you describe in a proper way? Systematic way, please.
Abhishek, MTS, please go ahead.
See, it is very simple what Mahendra Bhai is saying. Any sonography CT you get in the exam, whether it is X-ray, KUB, CT, sonography, all you have to do is, this is a plain CT scan or a contrast and a CT scan of abdomen and pelvis. Liver, spleen, gallbladder, pancreas appear normal. Kidneys appear normal. Both the sides contrast be excreted. My area of interest is looking at the great vessels, because I am looking at inter-aortocaval and pre-caval nodes and also the pelvic nodes. Here I see both the great vessels are normal and maybe some lymph nodes are involved. That is the way. Whether it is X-ray, KUB, you have to comment about preparation, bony structure, architecture, any foreign body seen, like that.
Okay, sir.
Mahendra, can you just give them some?
Ha, sir. So just what area has been covered? So first, whenever you see any CT scan, you just have to take 5 minutes, take 10 minutes with cool and calm mind. That first you see non-contrast image, first you see which area has been covered, then you see contrast or non-contrast or contrast, then first see non-contrast, then see the contrast, then your brain will analyze what is the difference between contrast and non-contrast. Okay, so you should always start with that. This is the contrast enhanced CT scan of a scan covering the thorax, abdo, pelvis, or only abdo, pelvis. Okay. And you can see the whatever areas are normal, first you describe those, or whatever areas abnormal, you describe that you have to decide which to describe first. So it should, description should be like that. If the examiner closes his eyes and whatever you described, okay, when he opens his eye, he should see the same thing, whatever you have described. That makes examiner very much this thing impressed. Okay, so in this case, if you ask me to describe, I will say it is the CT scan of abdo and pelvis with lower cuts of chest are seen, and in the chest and the solid organs are normal, the kidneys appears normal. I did not find any, I cannot appreciate any large retroperitoneal lymph nodes, and bladder appears normal, no pelvic lymphadenopathy. That's all. This is done.
Okay.
Right, Imtiaz and Abhishek?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and if anything anything is abnormal is there, you have to describe in detail, right?
Okay, sir.
Yeah, this is the way where how you should describe the CT scan.
Okay, Achin, now yes. Give them, yeah.
CT scan of abdomen pelvis, it shows you enlarged lymph nodes, not in aortocaval,
P-cable and left paraortic region. The largest nodal mass is seen in the auricular region, measuring about 3 into 2.7 centimeter in size, with no necrosis or calcification.
Okay, so can you tell me the right testis and left testis nodal stations? Step by step, how do they get spread?
Sir, the right test is the first echelon of drainage, sir. Pre-aortic, para-aortic nodes, sir, and the inter-aortocaval nodes.
Right side.
Inter-aortocaval and para-caval.
Para-caval.
And then it goes to?
Para-aortic.
Para-aortic. Okay.
Para-aortic.
And left side?
Para-aortic and inter-aortocaval, sir.
Hmm?
Para-aortic and then
inter-aortocaval, and then it goes. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Just a common question, just for your knowledge. Why in malignancy we always get the left supraclavicular node, not the right one?
Sorry, sir?
Why in malignancy, whether stomach malignancy, breast malignancy, or any malignancy, why we always get supraclavicular node, left side, not of the right side?
Sir, opening of the thoracic duct is on the left side, sir. Mets travel through the thoracic duct and get deposited.
Because the lymphatic flow is from right to left. Okay, right. Good. Yeah. Okay, fine. So now you have a CT scan which is showing some retro peritoneal node. Okay.
Density.
Now, Gita sir, anything you want to add? Yeah, Gaurang Shah sir.
Just 1 point, CT, already they are anterior CT is again, as you told, better to do CT anteriorly. But along with CT, some examiner may ask, can you go ahead with CT chest? Is chest X-ray sufficient? Then if it is not sufficient, then what are the lacunae of chest X-ray? These questions can be asked.
So I think CA testis may CT chest, abdo, pelvis, all should be done.
Yeah. That's true.
And if examiner asks why 1.5% of the mets, particularly in subpleural region, missed in case of the chest X-ray. So CT chest can be defended by this. And another way is, this is our protocol in our institute, common answer in exam. If you are not able to judge anything, then better to tell it is protocol in our institute.
Sir, the easiest way to get out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Fine.
Please go ahead.
So now this is a situation. What you want to do, Abhishek? Sir, based on the report, sir, this becomes a case of a mixed germ cell tumor with the retroperitoneal nodes, more than 3 centimeter in size.
Why you are saying mixed germ cell?
Sir, because AFP, SCG, both are raised, sir.
No, but you don't have any histopathology diagnosis in your... So now next what? You have done a CT scan, you have done...
Better tell it like a testicular tumor. Late examiner asked me, tumne judgment kya kya hai? So phir bata. It may be the germ cell tumor, the non-germ cell tumor, जो भी है, उसको depend करेंगे examiner पूछने के बाद. ठीक है.
Okay, sir. So now next one, now you come to a diagnosis that this is a testicular tumor, is a malignant tumor. Now what you want to do next? Sir, get a tissue diagnosis in the by doing a high valence orchidectomy, sir.
That now you are telling me this, and before that you are giving me a diagnosis, histopathology diagnosis.
Sir, based on the tumor marker, sir, I mean.
Yeah, barabar hai, I agree with you, but don't put your foot into the trouble.
Okay, sir.
Just so, say, na.
So yeah, Abhishek, Before going for any surgical procedure, you should always tell about the clinical staging.
Yes, sir. Sir, this is a clinical stage 2B, non-seminomatous germ cell tumor.
Why 2B?
Sir, because the size of the lymph nodes is more than, size of the retroperitoneal nodes is more than 3 centimeters. Sir. Three or more.
Good night.
Okay. And markers are S1, right?
Yes, sir.
Very, very good. So this is the way, okay? My clinical staging is T2. Now I want to have a histopathological diagnosis, okay?
Mahendra, you're not ask them about S1, S2, S3.
Sir, I told them to remember this thing. It is important when the, anyway, they can tell me S1, S2, S3, what is it? Abhishek?
Yes, sir. Sir, S1, S2, S3, sir, risk stratification for testing, testicular tumor, sir. For seminomatous, sir, there are only two risk stratification, S1 and
no,
S2.
No, this is wrong. S1, S2 is a categories of
level.
The markers, based on the markers. Okay.
Tumor marker level.
They have no relation with the
okay, category. Okay, I got it, sir. Yes, sir. S1, so S1, S2 and S3, sir. In S1, sir, beta HCG will be less than 5,000. AFP will be less than 10 and
1,000.
Yes, 1,000, sorry. And HCG will be less than 1.5 times the normal, sir. LDH. And
I'll just tell you how to remember it. How to remember it, okay? Can I tell you?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Just say ABL. ABL, right?
Okay, sir.
And 1.5. ABL 1.5. So S1 is equal to 1,000 of AFP. Beta SAG 5,000. LDH 1.5 times. ठीक है?
Okay, sir.
इसके बाद just 10 करना multiply S1, S2, S3 में.
Yes, sir.
Right? So
yes,
just sir. Remember ABL and 1.5.
Yes, sir. So S2 is 1,000 to 10,000 of AFP, beta HCG 5,000 to 50,000 of beta HCG, and LDH becomes 1.5 times to 10 times.
10 times, yeah.
Of and, LDH. And S3 is more than 10,000 for AFP, more than 50,000 for beta HCG, and more than 10 times the normal for LDH.
So is it not so easy?
It is, sir.
So method. Just you have to make things easy, how your brain can perceive things, only you can decide that. Okay, that was my method I was shared with you. If you okay with that, continue. If you have another method, you can remember that by that also.
Okay. Sir. Yeah. Yes.
Gaurang sir.
Fine. Go ahead. Yeah. You are doing well. Please continue.
Okay.
Next what you can ask them.
So now tell me what now you have a staging. Okay. You have a diagnosis, provisional diagnosis, clinical. Now, what will you do?
We'll go ahead with the hyoinguinal orchiectomy now, sir.
Okay. Why hyoinguinal? Why not a scrotum?
We'll have to excise, complete this cord structure so that there is no left behind micrometastasis if anything is there.
Cord
and we cannot violate.
Cord structures are goes from to the retroperitoneum.
No, sir. That we can take care in case there is we are planning for the retroperitoneal. There's no dissection,
yeah.
But we cannot.
While answering this question, yes. suppose incision is taken over the scrotum, what will happen?
Sir, the echelon of lymph nodes will change, sir. It will give a new avenue for lymph nodes in the inguinal region, sir.
So to avoid the local violation, this is the first line you. Should come from your mind to avoid the local violation. Why inguinal? To avoid
because,
the local violation.
Because the scrotum drains into the inguinal.
What you are telling is again one of the points. To excise the part right up to at or above the level of inguinal internal inguinal ring, so that it can be approached from inside whenever it is required in future when you are doing the some RP lint.
Yes.
Then here, what is the role of radical inguinal orchiectomy or high inguinal orchiectomy?
क्या रोल है, क्यों करना है. तो रेडिकल इंग्वाइनल आर्कोडेक्टॉमी एज अ डायग्नोस्टिक एज वेल एज थेरेप्टिक रोल. ओके, तो व्हाट डायग्नोस्टिक, इट कैन गिव हिस्टोलॉजी, इट कैन हेल्प इन लोकल स्टेजिंग, बट व्हाट थेरेप्टिक, इट इज द सफिशियंट ट्रीटमेंट फॉर सम टेस्टिकुलर ट्यूब. Like
yes, yes, sir.
Spermatocytic seminoma. At the age of 6 years, it is formed. Another yes, is sir. It is sufficient in stage 1 seminoma. Okay, low stage wala. So this is the role of therapeutic role of high inguinal architecture. And recently, one subfascial inguinal architecture, FPRO. UCNA mein last time bhi maine bataya tha. UCNA mein describe kiya. Fascia preserving radical architecture. Fascia preserving radical architecture. पढ़ लेना, UCNA में है. ठीक है.
Yes.
Then what is by Chevastu manure? Yes, world examiner है तो पूछ सकता है.
Yeah. So tell us what is the meaning of that? What are the indications?
Sir, it is done in case of we are planning for partial orchiectomy or we are planning for the testicular biopsy in a suspected case of testicular malignancy. We do Chevastu maneuver. We, after exploring the inguinal canal, we take early control of the spermatic cord by applying one vascular clamp or intestinal clamp and take the cool down the testes with the help of some ice and take biopsy or do partial orchiectomy.
It's done for patients who have unilateral testes and there is suspicion of malignancy in that single testes, or suspicion of malignancy in solitary testes, sir, can also be done for intertesticular germ cell neoplasia, sir, if in a solitary testes. Basically for testis preservation strategy, sir.
Fine.
So what are the indications? If it is a bilateral, then you will not do?
Yes, sir.
Sir.
Bilateral infertility is there. Solitary functional testis is there. Or just biopsy for the suspected lesion.
Now, what are the criteria? When you will do? Abhishek?
Yes, sir.
So, what are the criteria?
Sir,
small size sir, tumor of less than... Okay. Small size
yes,
of tumor
Abhishek.
Less... Huh? Sir, small size tumor of less than 1 centimeter.
2 centimeters. Okay. Number one, smaller than 2 centimeters. Second thing,
unilateral testis, a solitary testis.
No, there are indications. Indications are different. You have already talked about indication. It is a solitary testis, or the tumor is in both the testis. You want to find to diagnose. So these indications are over. How to do maneuver? That is over. Indications are over. Now you are coming to the criteria. Once you have established that yes, you want to go ahead. So as you said very rightly, less than 2 centimeters. Second,
sir, testicular microlithiasis.
That is an indication, na?
Okay.
Mahendra, microlithiasis is or this in calcification is an indication.
Sir. Sir, if the this is 5 to 10%, their chances of carcinoma in situ is more.
Okay.
So even we can observe many patients are there who has 20% of this thing, and we are observing a patient for years. Nothing happened then.
Nothing.
Yeah.
Particularly
so this is an indication. Now the criteria is what? Suppose a patient has come from village, he is not going to come back. Will you do it? Abhishek.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I would like to do it, sir.
If because he is not going to follow, will you do?
No, sir. Then I'll go, sir. With whether he's completed his family or not. What is the status of his fertility, sir? Any if he's close to if he is not amenable for follow up, sir, then we will wait, sir. We will not do.
You will not do it. No,
sir.
Then say le. What else? Achin, can you add?
What, sir?
Criteria. One is less than 2 centimeters. Second, patient is willing for a proper follow-up. Anything else we are missing?
Nothing as if I know.
Okay, fine. Anyway, if I remember, there were 3 criteria. If I remember, I'll just let you know. So how will you do high ligation, high orchidectomy or radical?
Gaurang sir, just one thing to add, which we forgot to mention about the evaluation. When any patient with the CA testis, we should always have a semen analysis.
Yeah.
Okay. And FSH, LH, and serum testosterone. These things should be always in hand before going for the orchidectomy.
Okay.
Yeah, it is in guidelines. We should follow that. Okay.
Fine.
Please note down these things. They're important thing which normally everybody misses.
Yeah, we don't. Yes, yeah, I agree with you.
Yeah.
So just can you repeat it again?
Sir, sperm, the semen analysis to see the quality of the sperms, FSH, LH, and serum testosterone.
Now the question is, even if he has completed his family, still we should go ahead with this, or
have to ask the patient whether we have to document it. The patient does not want. Sometimes patient have daughters, they want son after that, or maybe they got third, maybe some reason they want. So we have to document it. Patient committed family, no further issue from his side. He did as it like that.
Sir, if this is documented that he has completed his family and he doesn't want any more issues, then the definitive treatment is orchidectomy only, sir.
Yeah, but you don't need to do all those tests. Only thing is, suppose that any patient having bilateral testicular mass, okay, you have to remove both the testes. Definitely, he's going to have testosterone replacement therapy.
Yes, sir.
Right? So in those patients, you have to have this baseline. Not a sperm analysis, but definitely these LH, FSH and testosterone you should have in your hand.
Yes.
Yeah. Fine.
Fine. So, okay, now how will you do? Radical orchidectomy or high orchidectomy?
Will you give, sir, about 3 to 4 centimeters long incision in the inguinal region of dissecting the subcutaneous tissue will divide this external oblique aponeurosis. Look for the ilioinguinal nerve and cord structure. Will have to control the cord before delivering the testes into the wound. Control it with this vascular clamp or the bowel clamp. After that, deliver the testes into the scrotum and separate vas from the cord structures and tie them separately and remove the specimen.
Mahendra, you want to add anything to this?
Yes, sir. Two things. First of all, we have to save the ilioinguinal nerve in the inguinal canal. We have to separate it from the spermatic cords. Okay. And definitely we have to clamp the cord at the internal inguinal ring. And I prefer personally to, after clamping the cord, just cut it from there and suture it and then held the testis this thing. Sometime if I am handling a testis before removing the cutting the cord and that clamp get dislodged, maybe some got loose by anybody by mistake, the theoretical chances of tumor seeding from the spermatic cord to the intra-abdominal area part of the by the this thing spermatic veins. So that's why only this thing, two things I wanted to highlight over there.
So we have got also Ganesh Bakshi with us. Ganesh, you want to add anything in high orchidectomy, any message or any guidelines you want to tell them? I think he's muted. He will tell us later on. Okay, fine. So, Ajay, now show what is the result of orchidectomy.
Sir, one more thing I forgot to tell that the distal part, the gubernaculum, should always be tied or transfixed. Because it may lead to hematoma sometime.
Yeah. Okay, so this is exactly what we have done. Fine. So what is it? I just want to tell you that, in fact, we did the CT scan after this orchidectomy. So that is why they don't have the report of CT scan in histopathology.
Histology shows a mixed germ cell tumor comprising of seminoma 10%, embryonal carcinoma 20%, yolk sac tumor 25%, choriocarcinoma 20%, teratoma 25%. Overall, it's a mixed germ cell tumor with pathological staging T1B.
Yeah, Ganesh, now this is a situation. Now, yours and Mahendra's role is most important. So, you have joined us at the right time.
Sir. Sir, it's a video I'm keeping off because there's a data problem. And actually, I was hearing earlier when the battery went off. So, Mahendra is taking it really well. So, let's continue. I'll participate, sir.
Yeah. So now this is a situation. So Mahendra and you have to now take them, you know, further how they are going to treat this patient.
Right. So let it continue. I mean, मुझे थोड़ा सा idea आ जाएगा because I have joined just now. Mahendra will continue.
Okay.
Mahendra.
So tell me now. You have a histopathology report. You have CT scan. You have tumor markers. Now what will you do further?
We'll repeat the tumor markers, sir. Four weeks after the surgery.
Okay.
So anything else before that you want to do? The most important thing in cancer management. Patient counseling, right?
Sir.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
After the biopsy report, what will you do? What will be the plan of action? If this happens, what will be the next plan? Like that. Okay. You have to prepare him psychologically. Okay. Right.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes. Fine.
Yeah, this is the most important thing. We always discuss this. We do it. But when it comes to exam, most of the people, they forget about counseling. You know, telling this. Yes. That's the most important.
Okay, fine. any condition where we don't do orchidectomy and we start treatment, systemic therapy?
Yes, sir. If the patient has extensive metastatic disease who presents with the symptoms like respiratory distress or large, there is compression of the great vessels, then in such case, we can go ahead with the chemotherapy and at a later date, we can do the orchidectomy. Sir.
Any more specific conditions? You can look at the histopath report which is given here. It says yolk sac, seminoma component, embryonal cell, I think chorio. 1 minute.
And teratoma, sir.
Yeah, so chorio. Yeah, so anything. So you said technically only two things. One is very large metastatic burden, but per se metastatic burden doesn't count. Patient is breathless, with that it counts. Sometimes patients have hematemesis because of retroduodenal nodes which erode into the duodenum. Chorio I mentioned specifically because I thought you would take the cue from that. Chorio. Chorio has beta HCG levels very high. And when beta HCG levels are very high,
brain metastasis patient can have.
Yeah, that is a suspicion of brain metastasis, but those are the conditions when sometimes you may not even, you might get 5 lakhs and plus. So you may not wait for this thing, tissue diagnosis.
It spreads very rapidly via the hematogenous root choriocarcinoma.
Yeah, let's proceed, not waste time. Yeah, so just to complete Mahendra's question.
Okay, so now we have CT scan. In what condition will you do a CT brain?
The answer should be very fast. It should be like anyone? 1, 2, 3.
Patient is symptomatic for brain mets, or patient has very high beta ICG levels, more than 50,000.
No, now it's 5,000, not 50. Now it is 5,000. Okay.
Yeah, 5,000.
You should do a CT brain. What about the fancy investigation, FDG PET scan or any PET scan like that, in CA testis?
Only seminomas are sensitive to FDG PET, sir. Otherwise, it has no role in non-seminomatous tumors, sir.
Why?
Because of teratoma, sir. Teratoma, that is non-FDG avid, sir.
Very good. Because it may have non-teratoma component that may mislead us with the report. And what is the role of FDG PET in seminoma? You just said, Abhishek.
Sir, to rule out recurrence, sir.
Post chemotherapy, sir.
Post chemotherapy.
Further management. We can.
Further management after first primary chemotherapy.
So when
the residual disease is more, if the residual disease is more than 3 cm size, then we have to do FDG PET CT. If it is showing uptake, then we can go ahead with the retroperitoneal lymph node dissection. If it is not FDG avid, then we can just observe them.
So what is the ideal time to do PET scan after chemotherapy in case of seminoma?
After 6 to 8 weeks.
6 to 8. Up to, the reports has been there up to 2 months. The size reduces of a seminoma after the chemotherapy. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. What is this? PET scan was done?
Yes, sir. PET scan was done.
Okay. So what is it?
It shows, sir. Post right orchidectomy status is noted with no abnormal enhancing soft tissue in surgical bed with small to enlarged metabolically active lymph nodes seen in the autocable region, retroperitoneum suggestive of metastasis, and no other significant metabolically active lymph nodes seen elsewhere in body, and no other abnormality seen elsewhere.
So means we were wrong, right? This pattern shows metabolic activity, right?
Yes, sir.
Sir, any comment on this?
Sir, actually, a CT scan, CT abdomen has shows 3 into 2.7 centimeter. The PET CT has shown the lymph node mass is 4 into 3.7 centimeter.
So, yeah. Mahendra, if you see the primary, it has a big mixture of everything.
Everything, yeah.
Including seminoma. So, what he read actually was the conclusion of the PET CT. Otherwise, there is a written 4 by something 3 centimeter SUV 16 mass in the retroperitoneum, 3.7, 4 by 3.7 centimeter. So it's a big node.
Yeah.
So I guess, right. Very technically speaking, if this patient has a CT scan, thorax, abdomen, pelvis before right high inguinal orchidectomy, I would not repeat a FDG PET scan at this point in time. Because if there is a 4 centimeter node, and the tumor markers are clearly saying that it is a NSGCT, as also confirmed by the HIO, probably the treatment would be different. I mean, we know that the treatment has to be given.
Yes, sir.
So there is no need of this PET CT at this point in time, if there is a CECT TAP earlier. So how would you... Mahendra, actually, मुझे वो connect नहीं है कि हम लोग कौन से stage में हैं तो क्या आगे करना है तो इसलिए तुम ही आगे ले लो ये
sir, it is stage 2B HPR report, you know, the node retroperitoneal right side tumor, right side testicular mass, and having a testicular node of around 3 to 2 cm.
Yeah, मतलब CT says 4, अभी इधर तो 4/3 लिखा है, so technically stage 2B NSGCT mixed tumor.
Right, right.
So what should we do?
Sir, abhi operatory has been done. That's all. Or staging. Abhi next question was when they are going to do a markers for that.
Yeah.
After orchidectomy.
4 weeks after orchidectomy, sir.
Yeah. 4 weeks. You're technically right, but roughly the answer should be after 5 half-lives. Remember that. So if you want to impress the examiner, you can say that something like 5 half-lives after 4 to 5 weeks.
Okay. Do we have?
So repeat tumor marker size we don't have.
Yeah, so that is another important thing. It should be there.
Okay, so now let me put a condition. One condition, tumor markers are normal, and second condition, tumor markers are raised. And one condition, how will you proceed?
If the tumor markers are normal, we'd like to go for RP-LND, sir. In case tumor markers are raised, we'll give induction chemotherapy.
Why is it so? When markers are normal, right?
Yes, sir. And when markers are raised, it can be teratoma. If we give patient chemotherapy, it can be tumor resistant and disease can progress. So better to take control by the surgical resection.
So if I ask you how much relation between the pathology of testis and the retroperitoneal mass, the correlation, because in HIU you have everything, right? So yes, how sir. Are you sure that in the RP node there will be only teratoma? You should defend yourself. Whatever you said, if it is correct, you should know why you are saying. It is not like by chance you said that and it is correct. Right?
Not only teratoma, part of the disease can be the teratoma. Sir.
So you should, your answer should be like that. If the markers are normal, there is no micro metastasis disease anywhere. Okay? This is that is the only site of the disease. Right?
Yes, sir.
And that should be dealt. We should not ignore that. And what happened if there is a markers are raised after 5 weeks.
That means micrometastases are there and we should take control with chemotherapy.
Either micromets, a viable tumor in the retroperitoneum.
Yes, sir.
Right? Yes, sir. Two possibilities are there. But most possibility is the viable tumor is in the retroperitoneum. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Right.
Okay. Then what will you do?
Sir, but then, sir, will this not patient be eventually a candidate for RP-LND, sir, because of the teratomatous component, sir?
Sir, I am giving you this thing, two condition, no? Markers are raised and markers are not raised, are normal.
Yes, sir. So, if markers are normal, which means the retroperitoneum is the only site of disease, like you mentioned, so an operative management will be optimum, sir.
Yeah.
And like Imtiaz said, if the tumor markers are still raised, there is an evidence of micrometastasis. So that should be controlled initially with the help of chemotherapy, sir. And then move on to operative if at all required.
When will you operate after the chemotherapy? You will operate or you will assess something?
Restage the disease, sir.
We restage the disease, sir. There is a pathological downstaging sometimes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So again, tumor markers are normal. Then we will proceed post-chemotherapy RP-LND, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if I ask what type of RP-LND will perform if the markers are normal in this case? Stage 2B.
Now sparing RP-LND, sir.
Now sparing. What type of RP-LNDs are there?
Sir, now sparing only I have heard, sir.
Okay. Anybody else?
The primary RP-LND, post chemotherapy RP-LND, post salvage chemotherapy RP-LND, desperation RP-LND, and reoperative RP-LND. Sir.
Okay. So you can divide RP-LND as a indications, like you said, right? Primary RP-LND, post chemo RP-LND, redo RP-LND, salvage RP-LND, desperation RP-LND, right?
Yes,
and based on the extended dissection, okay?
Yes, sir.
This is bilateral standard template, and modified or non-sparing RP-LND.
Yes.
These are the divisions of RPLND as per the indications and as per the extent of dissection. And now sparing RPLND. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Fine. Sir, anything you want to ask? You think technique? To...
Achint, I have. I have sent you the post of results.
Yes, sir.
So you can just show them.
Yes, sir. It will take a while.
Yeah. Mahendra, you can just go ahead. You can ask the different scenarios to them now.
Yeah, so Mahendra was discussing stage, I think.
What we should do first?
2B with, yeah, sir. 2B NSGCT. If you go for, in fact, 2A, 2B, both probably, right? With marker negative, then there is a scope of null-sparing RPLND. If it is marker positive, the most likely management, as Mahendra said, is to go for chemotherapy.
Okay. So in this case, we should go for a chemotherapy.
So we don't have markers here, sir. But expectedly, if the markers like AFP, beta HCG are going to remain high, then with a 4 cm retroperitoneal mass, we need to go for chemotherapy.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
If this patient would have very borderline or negative markers after this orchidectomy, then I would maybe debate saying ki I would do a RPLND. We can see if what is the histopathology and then take a call what will happen further.
Okay. So, can you just guide the students that after 5 weeks you will like to do
repeat tumor marker shows LDH 398, beta HCG 3.99, alpha fetoprotein 6.88.
तो काफी हाई है ना ये
बस प्री ऑपरेटिवली इट वाज लाइक दिस
सो इट इज स्ट्रेट फॉरवर्ड मार्कर पॉजिटिव
इट इज प्री दिस इज प्री ऑपरेटिव
नो प्री ऑपरेटिव
दिस थिंग इज प्री ऑपरेटिव सर नाउ व्हाट आई एम टेलिंग इज पोस्ट ऑपरेटिवली पोस्ट हाइमन ऑर्किडेक्टमी एलडीएच इज स्टिल 398 बीटा एचसीजी इज 3.99 एंड एएफपी इज 6.88
So, if we take marker positive, no, it is best to give chemotherapy.
Okay. So, in this, so now what we have.
Mahendra, right? No, it's okay, no?
Yes, sir. Other markers are raised. Then we
have. So, straightforward, here at this juncture, we discuss two scenarios. Since one thing is very clear to everybody, we are below stage 2C. What we are talking is below stage 2C. Below stage 2C, 2C and age, we call it advanced. Testicular cancer. And we have a classification for that. I think that discussion is yet to happen.
Yeah.
Right, no?
Correct.
So this is where we are very clear that marker after HIO is positive or negative. If positive, we straightforward go for null-sparing RPLND, chemotherapy. Yeah. And Mahendra has already discussed what you do with negative.
Fine.
So, Abhishek, one more scenario.
Yes.
Suppose that this patient is not having a retroperitoneal node, right?
Yes, sir.
Just testicular mass. And you do HIO, and after 5 weeks, again, markers are something 100, AFP is 100, beta is 25, right?
Yes.
So, what will you do? No nodes in the retroperitoneum.
Sir, I would screen the chest.
Normal.
We have already done. When somebody asks you a question like that, we are already done.
Okay, sir. So in that case, given the histopath, I would like to go ahead with the retroperitoneal lymph node dissection, sir.
Okay. Don't you think clinical stage there is something which was there 1S.
Clinical stage 1S, sir.
1S with
your basic TNM classification should be damn clear if you are presenting a known testicular cancer case. I mean, all the scenarios and all the classification is like mathematics. Although we are discussing medicine, it's in testicular cancer, it's very mathematical. it all depends on your TNM, it all depends on your tumor markers, and the whole treatment is like in a protocol.
Sir, with the teratoma in the histopathology, sir, does he become a candidate for surgery upfront, sir?
I don't think this is the question which Dr. Mahendra has asked you.
No, sir.
And first you answer the question. I mean, let us not cultivate a habit where you ask a question in response to a question. So what he had asked you a question is about stage 1S NSGCT.
Yes.
So please answer.
Such patient should be treated as advanced disease. They should be treated with the induction chemotherapy, sir, as per the
some network issue.
Yeah, Mahendra.
Yes.
Haan, sir.
Yeah, you can answer them.
No, I sir did not hear what they said actually. Some network issue, his side or my side.
No. He said that he should go ahead with the chemotherapy.
He will give induction therapy. Then after that, what he said?
Induction chemotherapy, sir, will give as per the risk stratification of the patient.
What classification? Risk stratification.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Which one?
IGCCCG, sir.
Patient having no RP nodes. Only markers are raised.
See, stage 1S clinical is persistently elevated tumor markers after orchidectomy. What it indicates, technically it indicates subclinical metastatic disease or technically a chance of a second GCT in the other testis. So somewhere in the earlier part, we have ruled out, say possibly, that USG done doesn't show any pathology in the other testis. So we are talking about stage, what Mahendra is asking you, actually. And stage 1S is subclinical metastasis, which needs chemotherapy. So let's leave at that if you are not answering. So coming to one comment which you made just now, IGCCCG. Now, clearly IGCCCG is not applicable in stage 1S. IGCCCG is applicable in advanced germ cell tumor. I just said this few minutes back actually. And that is about 2C. So when we are talking of stage 2A, 2B, we really don't talk about IGCCCG. Clear for everybody, yeah, please.
Yes, sir.
Don't mistake that.
Fine. So, Mahendra...
Mahendra, tum chalu rakho. Next question.
Mahendra, chalu rakh bhai.
Okay. So, abhi, let us have a scenario of having a risk stratification. You are a little bit confused about this stratification. Okay. So, there are two types of stratification. One for the stage 1 disease and one for the metastatic disease. Metastasis. So, can you tell me if patient is having a localized disease, that means only in the testis, then how will you stratify the patient? And patient having a lung mets and RP nodes and large increased tumor markers, how will you classify those patients?
Patients with localized disease will see the histopathological examination on the basis of, for example, non-seminal motor germ cell tumors, lymphovascular invasion is present, embryonal cell carcinoma predominance is there. And in seminoma, this hereditary testis invasion or the size of the lesion is more than 4 centimeters.
No, it is not 4 centimeters. AGC7, it was 4. AGC8, it is. It is not 4 centimeters. It is 3 centimeters now.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Even I think in chat box, Gita sir also mentioned some 3 centimeters. I think you are not watching that. So this is for the stage 1 disease where you have to decide whether to give additional therapy or not, or keep patient under surveillance, or how to counsel the patient. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So how it just I have given you some hint. So how will you decide the management about the patient of a clinical stage one disease of having these risk factors or having not these risk factors?
Patients having these risk factors, they have a chance of recurrence of the disease in the retroperitoneum. So better if we treat them either with chemotherapy or retroperitoneal lymph node dissection. We cannot,
which case?
NMGCT,
right?
Yes, sir. If the patient is not having these risk factors, we can just keep the patient under surveillance, sir.
Okay, but if suppose a patient wants that, says that, you know, I don't want to undergo chemotherapy and radiation and surgery, even I am high risk, how will you counsel the patient? And what will you do? You cannot force the patient to undergo chemotherapy. You cannot force them, right?
Clinical stage, we have explained the patient that if he is opting for the surveillance, then he has to come on regular follow-up. He has to be ready for the regular CT scan and the disadvantage whatever of the screening are there.
No, I am asking you, I am having these factors, okay?
Yes, sir.
If I am having seminoma, my size is 5 cm, I have a tetrasis involved. If I am having non-seminoma, just said I am having LVI present and 90% of myself carcinoma. But I don't want to undergo chemotherapy and the surgery. I am ready for the active surveillance. What will you do?
Sir, 5-year survival rate of all the three are almost same. We can give patient the choice.
So you will leave me with active surveillance? How will you counsel me? I'm asking that because in cancer treatment, counseling is very important.
Yes, sir. Regarding counseling, you can tell patient, suppose if the patient is having recurrence, the treatment needed will be more aggressive treatment that time and the response rate will be less. Morbidity will be more.
No, why? You should just tell ki these are the chances of recurrences in future. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And patient understand all these risks of recurrences and disease progression. And despite of knowing that, he is opting for the active surveillance. And he's ready for the follow-up as per the active surveillance. Right?
Yes.
This is the answer of this question. Because you cannot force the patient to undergo chemotherapy or surgery. It is his right.
Okay, sir.
Sir, anything you want to add in this?
No.
Okay.
Fine.
Okay. Now you tell me a patient is having lung mets and markers. We can say somewhere 50,000 of AFP. Okay. And beta SEG is something 12,000. Then how will you stratify this patient?
Sir, it will come in the intermediate prognosis, sir.
Mm-hmm.
As per IGC, it will come in the intermediate prognosis.
Okay.
Yes, sir. There is no non-pulmonary metastasis and S2.
No, here the lung mets, no?
That comes in the non-pulmonary. There is no other visceral met. It comes in the intermediate group. Sir.
Intermediate. So can you just tell me the different factors for seminoma and non-seminoma germ cell tumor with good intermediate and poor risk?
Good risk, there is...
One by one. Abhishek will tell one and you tell second. Yeah, seminoma by the Abhishek, and yes. You tell the non-seminoma.
Sir, in seminomatous germ cell tumors, there is only good risk and intermediate risk. In seminoma, good risk, sir, any site of tumor, sir, any levels of tumor markers, and no non-pulmonary visceral mets is good risk, sir. Intermediate risk is, sir, any site of tumor with non-pulmonary visceral mets present and any levels of tumor markers, sir, is intermediate risk, sir.
So my main purpose to ask this question was to differentiate between all factors should be present or any factor should be present. Right? So when you say for seminoma, remember there is a criteria of all should be present. Okay. And non-seminoma, it is anyone it present, it will be the risk identification by the good, poor and the intermediate risk factor, prognostic group. right? And this is not true for only CA testis. It's true for any stratification. Chahe CA, it is whether CA prostate or CA penis or bladder, there should be a criteria. All should be present, or any one should present. That will put the cancer in that criteria. Okay.
Right, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead.
No. I think what to add. I'm just thinking. Now this thing is there. Ganesh sir.
क्या कुछ नहीं मतलब scenario.
हाँ मतलब ये तो अभी what important thing they should know about the classification that in the discuss.
I mean you should know the classification by heart and technically
yeah
as you know the classification the treatment just comes out.
Maximum in exam they can ask the boundaries of different type of RP90 because you are a surgeon or maybe the basic about the chemotherapy ki what chemotherapy regimen in anesthesia or
very like basic that. About bleomycin, etoposide, cisplatin. What is the toxicity of bleomycin? What is the known toxicity for cisplatin?
And maybe seminoma. Anybody can take this question. Seminoma stage 1 with risk factor. What do you prefer? Active surveillance, chemotherapy or radiation and why? Anyone?
Abhijit.
Sir, stage 1 seminoma with
high risk. With high risk.
Sir, I would go with radiation, sir.
Okay, Imtiaz.
Radiotherapy,
sir. Okay, why? So Imtiaz, why don't you go for chemotherapy and tell us the advantages of chemotherapy over radiation for stage 1 seminoma?
The toxicity, I would like to give radiotherapy. Survival is good with the radiotherapy.
No. See, you are giving exam. I am the examiner. I am telling you. He's already said radiation. So you have to say chemotherapy and defend chemotherapy. So why radiation is bad and why chemotherapy is good? See, theoretically, it is very simple. Since you are stuck. Both treatments can be used. Now, obviously, when there are two treatments, there are always pros and cons. What basically I'm asking you is, if you are, say, I put you as supporting chemotherapy, what are the pros and cons? Abhishek, why are you so fond of chemo radiation?
Sir, the morbidity is less, sir, and the cancer-specific survival for early-stage seminoma is better with radiation, sir.
The data now says that both are say same. So, you said morbidity is less with radiation. So, what kind of morbidity is there with chemotherapy? Can you tell me? It is a AUC-7 dose, single agent, one or two doses of carboplatin. Carboplatin is like a very good drug. So what is the morbidity? I asked the same question in other words to Imtiaz. Imtiaz, what is the problem with radiation?
Patient can have gastrointestinal toxicity.
Okay.
Urinary bladder toxicity, patient can have secondary
okay. See, whenever somebody is asking a question, no, there should be some order of priority to answer. So, if I am asking you this question, probably the first answer would be the incidence of second malignancies, which comes in these patients because of radiation. Now, you should know the percentage. Secondly, why second malignancies do arise in such patients? Which second malignancies arise? Bladder, hematolymphoid. And these patients are the ones who are going to survive. They are long-term survivors. Hence, more chance of second malignancies. SMNs, we call it in short form. With respect to single agent carboplatin, it's not a so toxic therapy. It is okay. Results have shown equal benefit. long term, very long term results are awaited. But whatever results we have up till now, there is nothing like, long term problems with chemotherapy. It's currently seen actually. So many people have switched over to single agent carboplatin. Obviously, we have reasons to give radiation also, but then in an exam, you should have pros and cons.
So in seminoma, you will prefer radiation.
Sir, if you're asking me, I might prefer single agent carboplatin also. Because as I said, these are long-term survivors and in them, then the chance of SM and second malignancies will arise.
Okay. So in that case, this is a reason you will not like to give radiation.
So what I said was, we should have pros and cons in everything pros like these things.
Yeah, yeah.
So when we have a patient and TMH, we take that call. Then.
Mm-hmm.
What will be good? What will not be good? Like.
Yeah. So you individualize in that case.
But I've seen in practice over the last like 2-3 years, we have probably a slightly more tilt towards single agent carboplatin.
Oh.
This is what I see in multidisciplinary meets nowadays.
Okay. Fine. Yes.
But Mahendra, sir, but for safer side, sir, as Gita sir has said, just you can escape by saying that this is my institutional protocol.
Yeah. When the choice is there, you can always say like that.
Yeah. But you should know the pros and cons. You should know why you are choosing that.
Institutional protocol is good way out. But if an examiner insists, tell me the benefits and risks of each modality, you will have to finally answer that. If you don't answer, it will be marked negative.
Correct. Yes. So Mahendra, now any other scenario?
We can do that. You have given chemotherapy. Post chemotherapy, what do you expect?
Yes, Abhishek, now quick.
Sir, post chemotherapy, sir.
I'll simplify it. Advanced germ cell tumor, say NSGCT 3A. Consider NSGCT 3A. Okay, you have given 4 cycles of BP. So, what do you expect?
Sir, I can expect regression. I can expect
What you are saying is correct. I mean, some things what you said later are expected in the histopathology. But generally, clinically, I'm asking. There are 2 things which you can expect. One is complete regression with tumor markers normal. Another is complete normalization of tumor markers with the mass remaining there. And third thing is both not happening. The mass remains or increases and the tumor markers increase or at least remain high. So there are 3 scenarios, right?
Okay, sir.
You understood all 3?
Got it, sir.
So how you will deal with all 3? That is the question. The first scenario was both regress, tumor markers and mass. So how much in an NSGCT you want the mass to regress?
Abhishek, answer.
These are all clinical questions. I mean, these are all very straightforward questions. Less than 1 centimeter, correct. And tumor markers normal. So I would probably closely follow up this patient. This patient does not then need an RP-LN. Okay. Then next question in this particular scenario was, how will you do the follow-up protocol? So that you read. The second scenario is tumor markers normal and the mass remains. Say we had 4 by 3.7 centimeter, or say we have 6 by 7 centimeter mass and a mass of 3 by 2 centimeter post chemotherapy NSGCT remains. Now what we'll do? Tumor marker normal.
RP-LND.
So your answer is absolutely correct. If feasible, try to answer like, I will counsel the patient and do a bilateral complete template RP-LND with maximum whatever nerve sparing I can achieve. So something you should try to improvise on your answer. So the third scenario. Third scenario, I think, was tumor markers remain higher and the mass may still, what you say, either remains the same size or increases. What will you do?
Will you, sir, second line this chemotherapy?
Systemic second line chemotherapy.
So you should at least be able to tell us what would be the drugs, names of the drugs. I'm not asking you details.
We have etoposide, ifosfamide, cisplatin,
taxanes.
थोड़ा सा खिचड़ी हो गया मिसल जैसा. So VEIP or TIP, at least whatever you should mention. So VEIP would be the proper thing.
GIP sir, gemcitabine, etoposide and.
नहीं इतना दूर मत जाना. उसके पहले तो TIP भी देते रहे जी. So we would definitely try one more line of chemotherapy, at least a VEIP. But in some cases where VEIP is given already in the first shot, okay. We classically say BEP is given, but some people will have already compromised pulmonary function test or some other problems. And then, you know, instead of BEP, we give VEIP in the first line for many patients. In that case, we have one regime remaining, which is a TIP, which is a classic regime given. So sometimes there would be a multidisciplinary call looking at a mass to do a desperation RPL. But many times we would give additional line of chemotherapy, then see what happens, and then do a rethinking. Okay. So, or kuch. When would you consider, this is just a question, when would you consider contralateral testis biopsy?
Imtiaz?
Yes, sir.
I don't know. Mahendra, ek cover hua hai kya question?
Nahi hua.
Yeah. Well, this is an early question, but I'm just asking, when would you do a contralateral testis biopsy? Do we do usually? We don't do.
Patient has atrophic testes or contralateral testes.
Yeah. Atrophic testes, I think the guidelines mention something like less than 12 or 13 ml testes.
Less than 12.
Yeah. And
cryptorchidism, sir.
Yeah. So that these are the so-called indications of the testicular biopsy.
Contralateral.
So, I think the scenario of undescended testis is remaining, right?
Yeah.
Mahendra, wo pooch lo jara, please.
Kya, sir?
Undescended testis baki hai. So, if there is a right undescended testis in this patient, so patient presents to you with a kind of, say, lower abdominal inguinal mass. Tumor markers are initially at presentation raised. LDH is say 300 and beta HCG is 100. AFP is 2. How will you manage?
We'll do one CT abdomen pelvis, sir, chest abdomen pelvis, sir. After that, we will post the patient for...
So CT, thorax, abdomen, pelvis says that thorax is normal. Abdomen is technically normal, except there is a mass in the lower abdomen besides the bladder. It's in close proximity to the internal ring. And rest of the kidneys are normal, ureter normal. The left testis is in the scrotum, normal, looking normal on CT.
We'll post the patient for surgery so that we can get the tissue diagnosis.
Okay, so what surgery you want to do? It's an intra-abdominal testis. I said no, internal ring ke idhar hai, andar.
Yes, sir. All correctly we'll do, sir.
Okay. So that is a given line. I mean, undescended testis, technically you can do an orchidectomy even then, and then follow the routine protocol. Versus there are many schools of thought where they give a chemotherapy first and then do an orchidectomy. So in UDT, both these schools of thoughts are practiced. There is another scenario where you might have an undescended testis with elevated tumor markers, looking like an NSGCT with retroperitoneal mass, say of 5 centimeters. Any change in management? Imtiaz?
Sir, we can have this tissue diagnosis by CT, CT guided biopsy of the nodal mass.
नोडल मास क्यों वो सिटी गाइड बायोप्सी तो तुम टेस्टिस का भी कर सकते हो या फिर तुमने पहले पेशेंट में जैसे ऑर्किडेक्टॉमी किया वैसे प्लान नहीं है
देन वी विल प्लान इन स्टेजेस सर फर्स्ट वी विल डू द ऑर्किडेक्टॉमी डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द हिस्टोपैथोलॉजी एंड नोडल मास इज मोर देन 3 सेंटीमीटर्स विल सब्जेक्ट द पेशेंट टू कीमोथेरेपी
सो इनिशियली व्हेन यू सेड बायोप्सी फ्रॉम नोडल मास व्हाट वाज द रीजन
To confirm whether there is some other pathology in the retroperitoneum or it is germ cell tumor only, sir.
Okay, that way. Okay.
So, Ganesh, what is your answer? What is your take on this? You do the same thing?
Sir, we might just do a tumor markers, and if necessary, tissue biopsy can be done from the undescended testis only.
Okay.
So if the primary landing zone has nodal metastasis, then we don't separately prove that they are metastasis from testis.
Okay.
Would go for a chemotherapy.
Hmm.
In this second scenario, first scenario, I fully agreed with him that we can go for a orchidectomy because ECT TAP was normal. Here we would go for a chemotherapy and then maybe do a post chemotherapy evaluation again. Depending on that evaluation, take a call what surgery has to be done. If the mass has completely regressed in the retroperitoneum, then we are left with the testis only. That okay. surgery can be done either open or laparoscopic. Or if the mass is present, that upper mass, then we can do an RP LND along with
orchidectomy.
Yeah, orchidectomy at the same time.
Oh, okay.
So, Abhishek. Yes. What are your views on doing RPLND open laparoscopic robotic? Any papers you have read? Because I'm not asking you about your experience or institution experience. Any papers you have read which tell you something about this?
Sir, robotic RPLND access is better, sir.
Open lap robotic. See, try to, as I said, structure or systematize your answer. Kuch bhi bol mat dena. Examiner will also restratify you into good candidate, bad candidate. So think before you speak. Or think, question puche to how can you speak? I may not suggest you the best possible answer, but I at least want to guide you that think before you speak. I asked you a very pointed question. Open lap robotic. I know that you may not be exposed to these surgeries. So we are... after your reading. So what papers and what is the general thing you have read?
Abhishek, you know any paper?
No, sir.
Okay.
So technically for most of the times, the RPLNDs have been going open. Then there was an era when lap RPLNDs were being attempted. Lap RPLNDs, when they started, obviously, there was a selection of patients. Since the onset of robotic RPLND papers have come, people have been in a learning curve and now many people are doing it. Initial series always were case selected ones. But there are certain advantages to robotic. We still find some limitations to applying robotic technique to all patients of RPLND. Basically, because... many times the nodes are stuck to the major vascular vessels. And very large masses, maybe it is difficult to achieve a minimally invasive surgical status. So Mahendra, you have any comments on this? You can give, please.
Yes, sir. For minimally invasive, I think stage one is the ideal candidates who are to undergo robotic or laparoscopic. Stage two and above, I think they are best to deal with the open method. Yeah. Or maybe a very experienced robotic surgeon.
Right. Right. That is a good answer for a candidate in exam if this question is asked. So for experienced centers, you can go for it. And in selected cases, probably.
I think this is a better answer.
नहीं सर, पहले मैं पूछ रहा था कि थियोरेटिकली व्हाट द कैंडिडेट हैज रेड लाइक.
करेक्ट.
सो द आंसर इज दिस ओनली.
या.
एनीथिंग एल्स रिमेंस? इफ समथिंग अबाउट फर्टिलिटी डिस्कशन हो गया, फर्टिलिटी.
सर, हाउ टू एवलुएट एंड व्हिच पेशेंट टू एवलुएट वो हो गया था.
ओके.
हां, आई डिड नॉट टेल इट सर, इट आल्सो हैव सम मेडिको लीगल इंपॉर्टेंस आल्सो. सो नेवर don't try to miss it. It can be medical legal thing. Okay.
Correct.
And only sir, one scenario just I remember one scenario is there. You suppose that you gave a chemotherapy and patient having retroperitoneal mass with lung single lung lesion also of 2 into 3 cm. Imtiaz, how will you proceed?
Post chemotherapy, sir.
Yeah, post chemotherapy.
I will do
single lung lesion bilateral, single lung lesion bilateral.
And your retroperitoneum, sir?
It is 2 by 2 cm mass, easily operable.
Sir, I would like to do tumor markers. If the tumor markers are normal,
normal. I'm just giving you a situation. This aspect is not been discussed. Just I don't want to discuss this thing only.
I will do retroperitoneal lymph node dissection. Wait for the biopsy report. If the biopsy shows it is necrosis, then I will just keep the patient under observation.
Why?
If it shows, because it is a predictor of histopathology in the thorax, lesions in the thorax. If it is a viable malignancy, then we'll have to resect the disease in the thorax also.
So how much correlation?
Percentage, I don't know, sir.
He doesn't know. Mahendra, you can just answer them.
So it is, there is a 90% chances of correlation with the RP node and the lung mets. Okay. And 20% chances is a discordant also. Yeah. So suppose that if there is a bilateral lung mets and you remove the RP node and there is a necrosis. And if you remove the single side lung and that also become necrosis, then don't touch the other side lung.
Okay.
So why this carries importance is, just I'll add one line, Mahendra.
Yeah.
If the so-called single met, which Mahendra says, in such an area that you are going to, for that removal of that post-chemotherapy residual, whatever, you are going to remove a big part of a lung. Then probably we should apply that concordance logic and observe the lung lesion post chemotherapy, whatever is the remnant. And if it is steady, then it remains steady. That is what he is trying to tell you.
Okay. But can we take an aspiration biopsy or something from the lung?
You can take, sir. But the logic about concordance works much better. Because these are very established ones.
Okay. Fine.
Yeah.
And again, the question will arise. Suppose if you take a biopsy, the biopsy value is always there when you find something positive.
Correct. Negative.
There is a good chance that you will get inconclusive.
Yeah.
So that is a big problem. So positive means in this particular case, either necrosis or fibrosis or viable malignancy.
Fine. Good scenario.
Yeah. So I think, sir, no other scenario is remaining.
I think everything has been discussed, actually.
Fine.
Anything students want?
If you want to ask anybody.
Ask something which we missed, actually.
Yes, any question in the chat box? Achin?
Kuch hai to pooch lo, I think. Unmute and ask.
Yeah, chat box, mein, I think Gita sir left.
Gita had some urgent call.
So we end, sir? Yes.
I think it was a very good discussion.
Chaliye.
I'm really happy that at the end both of you took over and completed it.
Mahendra was actually doing it fantastic.
Mahendra was very good. Fantastic. So Mahendra, yeah, please.
So Mahendra, we request you to join next time also.
Yeah, sure, all sir, the malignancies sir, with definitely, no EBP sir, there. And I'll give him the topic in advance so that he can prepare the questions also as per your protocol. And if,
yes, sir, Mahendra, sure,
in that case, if you have got some extra material, okay, and scenarios, you please present also. We will be
so
very
what
happy.
We can okay possibly
we
do,
have some
Mahendra,
case capsules,
is,
sir.
Mahendra,
case capsules, huh?
What we can try to do is we can ask one of our fellow to make one very short presentation in some topic of that cancer.
Yeah.
Matlab,
sir, teaching topic, matlab, you want to see some slides of for teaching?
Kuch bhi ek. Matlab, suppose if we take urothelial, so we can have one small presentation on biomarkers. Just lateral, little lateral.
Matlab, any topic of that cancer, you want to say that? Not whole cancer, topic of that cancer.
Sir, apun ye kar sakte hai, matlab, Gaurang sir.
Bol.
Aisa. Matlab, and hum log kya kar sakte? Generally, Tanvi asks, who will present?
Correct.
So what we can add value is TMH से हम किसी एक फेलो को बोल सकते कि एक छोटा टॉपिक लो, वैसे ही एक छोटा टॉपिक किसी और स्टूडेंट को दे सकते कि यू प्रिपेयर 10 स्लाइड्स इन गुड डिटेल अबाउट दिस थ्योरेटिकल पार्ट विद इन दैट सेम कैंसर बीइंग प्रेजेंटेड.
ओके,
सो इट माइट ऐड वैल्यू, मतलब समथिंग मोर देन व्हाट वी हैव बीन डूइंग.
फाइन, आई एग्री विद यू. राइट, एंड इन सीए पेनिस आई वांट यू टू शो अस ऑल दोस स्लाइड्स व्हिच यू हैड शोन इन best zone.
Sir, wo to dikhayenge na. No problem, sir. We'll do that. Sure. Yeah.
And okay. Mahendra, if yes, you sir, have got like today, you talk to all different scenarios, na? If yes, you sir, have got something like that in any other case, that also you can show.
Sir, wo kya hai na? Bahut sara material rehta hai Mahendra ke paas.
Yes, yes. No problem.
Ho jayega, sir.
Sometimes we can do in the two lectures also. No problem.
Sir, वो क्या होता है ना, एक छोटी सी गड़बड़ में बताता हूँ कि ये कैसा है. This is the original program where we take this case taking.
Correct.
तो वो हो जाने दो.
I agree with you. We'll continue.
उसमें ना उसमें ये जो मैंने बोला वही value add करते हैं.
दो presentation. Small.
If we finish this series, no, then हम लोग एक panel discussion type जो आप महेंद्र को अभी बोल रहे हैं ना वो अपन चालू करेंगे.
Sure. Done.
बराबर ना महेंद्र.
सर टीचिंग से सर सही सर है वो सर आपने बोला अभी पैनल वाला पैनल का वो अच्छा रहेगा सर.
नहीं अच्छा रहेगा बट क्या है कि ये हम लोग करते हैं बिकॉज़ दिस पीपल नीड अ प्रैक्टिस ऑफ प्रेजेंटेशन आल्सो.
या ओके,
सो एज गणेश सर वेरी राइटली विल कंटिन्यू द सेम वे. हां, विल कंटिन्यू द सेम वे, ओनली स्मॉल स्मॉल प्रेजेंटेशन अलोंग विद दिस एंड देन एट द एंड वी विल हैव अ पैनल डिस्कशन.
ओके
सर, वो पैनल डिस्कशन का मैं तो बोल रहा हूँ कि वी कैन कीप सम सेपरेट मीटिंग.
सेपरेट नहीं, दैट इज व्हाट आई एम सेइंग. आफ्टर वी फिनिश ऑल केस प्रेजेंटेशन,
केस टेकिंग सीरीज खत्म हो जाएगी तो अपन रख देंगे.
ठीक, डन. गुड आईडिया.
गुड,
ओके, गुड नाइट एवरीबॉडी. थैंक यू सर.
गुड
नाइट
गणेश भाई, महेंद्र भाई, रेडी सर. गणेश सर, हेलो,
बोलिए
सर. जस्ट फ्यू लाइन फॉर द सर कैंडिडेट सर, जो लोग प्रेजेंट कर रहे थे, अभिषेक एंड इम्तियाज.
बोल दो.
अभिषेक, आर यू देयर?
यस सर.
हाँ, सो इन हिस्ट्री टेकिंग एज गीते सर सेड ऑन दैट टाइम यू कवर्ड एवरीथिंग बट एवरीथिंग वाज लाइक दिस थिंग वेरी हैफाजार्ड. ओके,
यस सर.
सो एवरी हिस्ट्री टेकिंग वेदर किडनी कैंसर और एनी बेनाइन डिजीज शुड हैव अ सम फ्लो. ओके,
राइट सर.
सो ट्राई टू दिस थिंग मेक दैट थिंग व्हेन यू एवर टेकिंग हिस्ट्री. ओके, एंड आई थिंक रीडिंग दास इज अ वेरी गुड आइडिया. डोंट फॉरगेट द बेसिक फ्रॉम द दास.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Both of you have done this for everybody. Well, this for everybody.
Both of you have done very well today.
Very well.
Yeah,
right.
Thank you, sir. मुझे एक छोटा सा चीज कहना है कि whenever an examiner asks you a question, no, just think in seconds before how you answer. If you try to think about the question and answer in a very organized way, it feels much better.
Okay.
Okay. Good night.
Okay,
bye.
Sir. Okay, sir. Good night, sir.
Good night,
bye.
Bye, Mahendra.
Good night, sir.
Bye.